الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم In last week's lesson we were looking at the recipients of zakat those people who are entitled to receive zakat. And I mentioned that the 8 people who are entitled to receive zakat, the name of these 8 people or the name of these 8 categories or recipients are mentioned in the Holy Quran. And in last week's lesson we looked at the first 4 categories, i.e. the fuqara, the faqir, the poor, wal masakin, the needy. Number 3, وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا Those people who are collecting zakat. And lastly, وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ Those people who you are giving zakat so that they come closer towards Islam. Or they could be believers, but you're giving them zakat so that they remain steadfast on their iman and on their Islam. Now the 5th category, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then goes on to say, وَفِي الرِّقَابِ i.e. someone or a gulam or a slave who is known as a riqab, you can give him zakat. Now obviously the category, this particular category and also the issue of a master and a slave, it doesn't really apply in this day and age as much, but I'm just going to very briefly explain that there are 4 ways a master can free a slave. So there's a master and he's got a slave or a slave girl under his possession. There are 4 ways where he can get this slave or this slave girl free from his possession. Now the first way, which is the most easiest way, is that the master says to the slave that you are free. Anta hurr. Now as soon as the master says that, automatically the slave will become free. He will do whatever he wants. And it's very similar, that particular rule is very similar to the rules and principles of divorce and talaq. This is a section which inshallah we'll look at later, where if a man was to say to his wife, you are divorced, irrespective of whether he had the intention of divorce or not, whether he said it for a joke, whether he said it to threaten his wife, it doesn't matter, as soon as he says that you are divorced, anti tualikun, automatically his wife will be out of his nikah, out of his marriage. Exactly here as well, that when a master says to the slave, anta hurr, you are free, then automatically, straight away, that particular slave will be out of the master's possession. So that's one way to free a slave. The second way to free a slave, in Arabic, is known as mudabbar. And mudabbar basically means where a master says to the slave that when I pass away, you are free. That when I pass away, when I die, you are free. So the ruling will be that when the master passes away, that particular slave will leave the master's possession and he will be considered as a free person. He will be allowed to do whatever he wants. The third category of freedom in Arabic is known as Umme Walad, making someone a Umme Walad or Istilad. And the way this one occurs is that a master, he has intercourse with his slave girl. So he has intercourse with his slave girl and his slave girl falls pregnant with the master's child. Now what will happen in that case is that when the slave girl gives birth to the child, that child will automatically become free. But that slave girl, the mother, what will happen is that when the master passes away, when the master dies, the slave girl, she will now automatically become freed as well. So basically the way this one works is, master, slave girl having intercourse, through their union, a child is born. The child automatically will become free, but the slave girl will only become free when the master passes away. And the fourth way of freeing a slave, which is mentioned in the Quran, wa fi riqab, is that a master, he does a contract with the slave, and he says to the slave that you pay me X amount, you pay me £500, you pay me £1,000, you are now free. Now what's the Quranic verse telling us what fil riqab? That those slaves who the master has done a contract with them that you give me X amount of money, you are free. If they are finding it difficult to pay the amount of, you can give them zakat money. They are worthy of zakat, they are recipients of zakat, you can give them zakat so that they can buy their freedom. So this is the meaning of the fifth category, wafir riqab. As I said, it's not that applicable in this day and age, similar to the fourth category we looked at in last week's lesson, wal mu'allafati qulubuhum. It's not that applicable, but obviously, you never know in the future, if it was to happen, then this particular masla would still arise in terms of if there is a slave who's finding it difficult to buy his freedom, to pay off his freedom, then in that situation, you can give him zakat money so that you can assist him and help him in buying his freedom from the master. Now, just a couple of things with regards to slaves. Now, remember, slave is something where, remember, a Muslim who's always been a Muslim, he can never ever be a slave. Similarly, people who are free, they can never ever be a slave. Those who are slaves, or those in their lineage, if they had slavery in their lineage, is actually a sign that in their lineage, there was disbelief and there was kufr. In terms of their father or their grandfather, they were non-believers. And then what happened when the Muslims conquered that particular land, and make their men into slaves and their women into slave girls, that's where you have the system of slavery. Someone who's always been a Muslim, in the history there won't be any slavery there. Similarly, someone who's freed, even though he may be freed from before, he can never ever become a slave. But those who are slaves, it's a sign that either themselves, they were non-believers, they were captured and then they were brought into the possession of a master, or like their forefathers, their father, their grandfather, great-great-grandfathers, they were non-believers, they were conquered by Muslims, that land was conquered by Muslims, then their men were now made slaves, and their females were made into slave girls. That is a sign of slavery. But remember, in this day and age, because many of the Muslim countries in particular, they signed up to the Human Rights Article, and I think Article 8, I think I may be wrong, but I think Article 8 is the rights of freedom, no person can be a slave and so on. So because as I mentioned this particular point before, that Muslims, whenever they sign up to something, it's like an agreement, it's like a promise, they have to fulfill it. So obviously if any Muslim countries have signed up to this particular, the Human Rights Act, then what will happen is that they have to abide by their laws. And because one of the laws is that, you know, the banning of slavery and so on, so therefore they can, that's why you hardly see any slaves around. Even in Muslim countries, there is no concept of slavery. But as I said, that if in the future, Allah Alam, we don't know what's going to happen in the future, if this system was to return back, then obviously if a person is finding it difficult to buy his freedom, you can give him zakat money and you can assist him to buy his freedom from the master. So that is the fifth category, wafir riqab. The sixth category, which is mentioned in the Holy Quran, is wal gharimin. And a gharimin is someone who is in debt. We've already looked at this masla before, a couple of weeks ago. There's someone who is in debt. Let's say you've taken out a loan from someone, or you borrowed some money from someone, £5,000, £10,000, and he's finding it difficult to pay that particular loan or debt or qarz off, what you can do is that you can give him zakat money and you can assist him to pay off that particular debt. As I explained a couple of weeks ago, even to the extent that you don't actually have to say to him it's zakat. You know that he's in debt, you can actually give him zakat money. In your heart you make the intention that this is zakat. You can give him zakat money and then you could say to him verbally, or this is like a loan on my behalf, or this is some kind of gift on my behalf, and so on. You can use other words, but if you in your heart were to make the intention of zakat, your zakat will be done. So that's the sixth category, wal ghanimin. The seventh category is waqeen sabilillah. Those who are in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can receive zakat and they are also entitled to zakat as well. Now, as I mentioned before, that this word waqeen sabilillah is very loosely used by many, many people. And they've said that anything which is fi sabilillah, anything where a person is doing it for the sake of Allah, that means he's doing it in the path of Allah, hence he is now entitled to zakat. And as I mentioned last week, that you know, sometimes people who run like television companies and so on or channels, they say, oh well, da'wah is a form of fi sabilillah, hence we are also entitled to zakat. Say for example a masjid, that's also fi sabilillah, hence we are entitled to zakat. An institution, that's fi sabilillah, that's also entitled to zakat. Any kind of da'wah center, that's also fi sabilillah, in the path of Allah, hence we can give them zakat. And this particular term is very, very loosely used. Anything which is fi sabilillah, it's just like giving out a leaflet, or that's fi sabilillah, you know, you can give him zakat as well. Even though he's rich, but he's giving out a leaflet, say after a talk, you know, he's fi sabilillah, he's doing in the path of Allah, hence he can give him zakat. So this term is so loosely used to such an extent that, you know, people who then use it, they normally use it for their own benefit. That's what they're actually manipulating the interpretation of that Quranic verse for their own benefit. That's how you look at it. It's not like they got mixed up here with the interpretation. No, the interpretation, the tafsir of the Holy Quran is very, very clear. And it explains that fi sabilillah here is someone who is in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of a mujahid, a warrior who's in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can only receive zakat. We look in the tafsir, it's quite clearly mentioned that. But those who then interpret it for themselves, they actually got, like sometimes people misinterpret verses. And the reason is because they probably didn't understand the context. Or like example, they read a few tafsir, a few tafsir books and come up with the wrong conclusion. But then you get some people who are manipulating the tafsir for their own benefit. They knew what they are doing, they know what they are doing, that this is the wrong tafsir, but they do it so that they can benefit from that. And as I said, like people who run like institutions, organizations, Islamic organizations, Islamic institutions, for their own benefit so that they could receive more money, more funds, what they do, they say, oh, fi sabilillah, you know, hence we are doing whatever we're doing, whatever organization we're running, that's also fi sabilillah, hence, you know, we can receive zakat money. Remember the fi sabilillah, the meaning of fi sabilillah here is warriors who are in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can only receive zakat. Another opinion, Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullah alayh, he's of the view that fi sabilillah here in this context means, or can also mean, sorry, a haji, i.e. a pilgrim, someone who's gone for hajj, and whilst in hajj, he's lost all his money. And it has happened to many people, as you know actually, that they've gone for hajj, and you probably think that when people go for hajj, it's going to be like, you know, the other people we're talking about, they're going to go with good intention. Unfortunately, what happens is that people, they go for hajj with the intention to steal from other people. So you probably heard many stories where people doing tawaf, they've got their kind of money bag around their neck or around their waist, and the people from behind with a knife or something sharp, they cut the money bag and take all their money. So there have been cases where, you know, people have lost their passports, people have lost all their money, whatever they had in their money bag, whatever they had around the waist, they've lost it when they've been going for tawaf and so on. So now if there is a situation where there is a pilgrim and he's lost all his money, lost all his passports, he needs some money to, you know, either go back home, or he needs some money to stay somewhere, or he needs some money to eat and so on, then in that situation, you can give that person zakat. So that's one interpretation of Imam Abu Yusuf rahimullah of the word fi sabilillah. So what we can gather is that there are two acceptable interpretations of the word fi sabilillah. That is either number one, a warrior in the path of Allah, or number two, a pilgrim who has lost his money, you can give them to zakat. And the last category which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned is wabni sabil, i.e. a traveler, a musafir. So a traveler is also entitled to zakat as well. So someone who's traveling, say for example, and he's lost all his money, in particular, this was again very common in the olden days in terms of there were, when people would travel by themselves, so there would always be like bandits and robbers around. So they would kind of, you know, get hold of them, take everything, loot whatever they had, and they would just leave them empty-handed. So it was very difficult for these travelers to return back home. So in the Quran it says what needs to be, the Sharia says that these travelers who had a lot of money, who may have a lot of money, say, at home, they may have mansions at home, they may have, you know, nice flashy cars outside, they've got a lot of money, but what's happened is that they've been looted, somebody has taken all their wealth, and they're now stuck. You can actually give them zakat so that they can return home, or they can return whatever, so that they could then get some money and then return home safely. So these are the 8 categories of zakat. Okay, lil fuqara, those who are poor, you can give them zakat. Number 2, wal masakin, those who are needy, you can give them zakat. Wal amilina alayha, those who are collecting zakat on behalf of the Islamic State, you can give them zakat. Wal muallafati qulubuhum, those who are giving them zakat so that they either remain in Islam or in Iman, or that they come closer towards Islam. The next category was fil riqab, as I was explaining, a slave who is finding it difficult to buy his freedom, so you can give him zakat so that he can buy his freedom. Wal ghalimin, someone who's in debt, you can give him zakat. Number 7, wa fi sabilillah, someone who's in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a warrior, you can give him zakat. And lastly, wa fi sabil, that someone who's a traveler. And also to a certain extent, in this category, you can also apply a pilgrim as well. Because when you look at a pilgrim or a haji, he's also a traveler as well to a certain extent. So obviously, if he's gone Hajj, if he's gone Makkah, Medina, Munawwara, he's lost all his money, then you can give him zakat so that he can return back to his homeland. So these are the 8 categories of zakat. Now what I'm going to do regarding this particular section, I'm just going to continue and look at some of the rulings which I haven't covered thus far. The next text here goes on to say, وَلِلْ مَالِكِ أَيَّدْفَعَ إِلَىٰ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ وَلَهُ أَيَّقْتَصِرَ عَلَىٰ صِنْفٍ وَاحِدٍ, which means that the person who is giving zakat, he's got a choice. Either if he wants, he can give zakat to each and every single category, because I mentioned 8 categories, so if he wants, he can give a bit of zakat to a poor person, he can give zakat to a needy, he can give zakat to wal-amili, someone who is collecting zakat, he can give zakat to a riqab, he can give zakat to fi sabilillah. So if somebody wants, he can give zakat to every single category. And he also goes on to say that also if he wants, he can just give zakat to just one category. He doesn't have to give it to any of the 8. If he just wants to, say for example, give all his zakat money to, say, a traveler who's lost all his money, he can give that. If he just wants to give zakat to a destitute, to a needy, he can do that. All his zakat which he has, if he wants to just give it to a poor person, then he's allowed to do that. The reason why I'm mentioning this ruling is because probably be aware that according to Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayh, he's of the views that zakat has to be given to every single category. So just say for example you have like £80 zakat you want to give. So according to Imam Shafi rahmatullahi, you have to give £10 to each category. So you need to look for a poor person, give him £10. You need to find a destitute, you need to give him £10. You need to find someone who's working and collecting zakat, give him £10. You need to find a riqab and give him £10. You need to find, say, a fi sabilillah, someone who's in the path of Allah, give him £10. Imam Shafi rahmatullahi is of the view that you have to give it to every single category. That's what Imam Shafi rahmatullahi is of the view. Obviously, probably their opinions may change nowadays because there's no such thing as riqab or slaves anymore. So it may be different nowadays, but initially, Imam Shafi rahmatullahi is of the view that you have to give it to every single category. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi on the other hand, he says there that you can give it to whoever you want. As long as they are from one of the 8 categories, you just give it to a poor person, you want to give all your zakat money. But I'll come back to later, you shouldn't give all your zakat money to a poor person, by the way. The ruling is that you shouldn't give him that much where the next year he now becomes liable for zakat. Basically, the threshold of zakat is around £300, as I explained. So you can't give basically £300 to a poor person. You have to give it less than that. So the amount that you give, it has to be less than the nisab threshold. Because if you are going to give him £300, then if he was to have that money for a year, he will now become liable for zakat the following year. So you should not give him basically, you know, thousands and thousands of pounds. Just give him like 200, 250 around that. That's the maximum you should be giving, and not more than that. Okay, the next text goes on to say, وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَيَّدْفَعَ الزَّكَاةَ إِلَىٰ ذِمِّيِّهِ, which means that it's not permissible to give zakat to a non-Muslim. Now, the two things here. One is optional sadaqah, and number two is zakat. Now remember, optional sadaqah, optional charity, can be given to non-Muslims. I think I may have explained this before, that if you were to find a non-Muslim, say, like begging, or sometimes they come to your house for a good cause, you know, like British Heart Foundation or these kind of things, or for a particular hospital, they want to build a hospital, or something like these kind of things, then you can give them sadaqah. Yes, it's known as optional sadaqah. You can actually give it to them. Nothing wrong with that. Totally permissible. And sometimes it could be like good in a way, because obviously if you were to give to them, then it could be a form of da'wah. Because if they did knock on your house and they asked you for, I don't know, some money for, I don't know, the British Heart Foundation, and you said, no, I don't want to give it to you, you know, you're a non-Muslim and so on, then you probably look a bit bad. So it's good in that situation, just give them a pound, give them a couple of pounds. With the intention of optional sadaqah, charity, then that would be considered very, very virtuous, and you get reward and sawab for that. So remember, non-Muslims, they can be given optional charity. However, they cannot be given zakat, because the recipients of zakat, as I explained, are those eight categories. And because zakat is like a worship, it's like ibadat. And remember, one of the main conditions of ibadat and worship is Islam. They have to be believers. So therefore, because of that reason, you cannot give zakat to non-Muslims. Some of the scholars like Imam Zufar rahimullah slightly disagrees here. He's of the view that you can give zakat to non-Muslims. Okay, obviously we're not going to go into detail here. He's got his own opinion. But according to the Hanafi school of thought, the mainstream Hanafis of the view that non-Muslims, non-believers, they cannot be given zakat. The next text then goes on to say, وَلَا يُبْنَى بِهَا مَسْجِدٌ, that zakat money cannot be used to make a masjid, or an institution, or a madrasa. Now, there's two reasons why. One reason is, because I already explained, some people may argue and say, well, isn't this fi sabilillah? As I explained, it's not fi sabilillah, because the definition of fi sabilillah is either a warrior or a pilgrim. And another reason why you can't give zakat to build a masjid or to build an institution or a madrasa is, as I explained a couple of weeks ago, that one of the requirements of zakat is tamlik, that you're making that person the owner. And because, and obviously only people can legally own things, can technically own things, and because buildings like masjid, madrasas, institutions, they cannot own things, if that makes sense. Even like a building, obviously we do say it belongs, like a masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's house, but one thing legally, that particular property has to be like owned by someone, or it was like owned by someone and then he donated to as a, like a waqf or an endowment. But because properties, because like madrasas, because institutions, because masajid, they cannot legally own anything, so therefore it's not permissible for you to give them zakat. Okay. The next section goes on to say, وَلَا يُكَفَّنُ بِهَا مَيِّتٌ, and similarly, you can't give, or you can't use zakat money to buy the kafan or the shroud of a deceased. So somebody passed away and he's very poor, so he needs, obviously, to bury him, the ghusl, the shroud being the kafan. Now what this particular ruling is telling us is that, you know, with the zakat money, you can't buy kafan and then give it to that dead person, give it to that deceased. Now, does anybody know why you can't do that? What do you reckon? Why do you think you won't be allowed to do that? Yeah, very good. There's no ownership here. There's no owner. He's obviously passed away. So obviously, as I think I may have explained last week as well, that when somebody passes away, then that's it. He doesn't own anything. Even all his property is now belongs to his inheritors and his heirs. So when somebody passes away, even though he's really, really poor, he can't afford kafan money or he can't afford a kafan, you can't use your zakat money to buy a kafan and then give it to that person and let him like, or you then shout that, you're not allowed to do that. That won't be permissible. What you can do, the way you could go around it is like, obviously just say it's his wife or someone or his children are poor. So you give them zakat money. You give them zakat money, but again, you can't stipulate that or use the zakat money for your that kafan. You can't stipulate that. So that's going to be impermissible as well. As I explained before, tamlid means that you give the total right or the discretion on how to use the zakat money to that poor person. So just say you've got a son who's alive, the father's passed away. You can give him zakat money to the son, but you can't place a condition there that or use this zakat money to buy your dad's kafan. Obviously, the son, if he has a bit of love for his father, obviously he's going to use the zakat money to buy his dad's son, but you can't stipulate that. Because obviously, if you then that kind of goes against the tamlid principle, which means that you totally make him the owner of the zakat money. Okay, so you can't stipulate that condition, and nor are you allowed to actually give the or buy a kafan with zakat money and shout the deceased to be. Because obviously he doesn't have any ownership of the zakat money. Your zakat will not be given in that situation. The next reading then goes on to say, وَلَا يُدْفَعُ إِلَىٰ غَنِيٍّ أَيُّ Zakat cannot be given to a rich person. And then he goes on to say that وَلَا يَدْفَعُ الْمُزَكِّي زَكَاتَهُ إِلَىٰ أَبِيهِ That a person cannot give zakat to his father, وَجَدِّهِ to his grandfather, وَإِنْ عَلَىٰ And also to his great-grandfather, and so on and so forth. I.e. to his ancestors. وَلَا إِلَىٰ وَلَدِهِ وَوَلَدِ وَلَدِهِ وَإِنْ سَفَلَىٰ And nor can he give zakat to his son, to his grandson, all the way down to his descendants. Okay, now this is a very important masla or ruling. Remember, you can't give zakat to your father or your grandfather. Basically, your ancestors and descendants, you can't give zakat. You want to look at it, just for example, those who are above you, and those who are below you, your ancestors, descendants, all the way down. So it could be like great, 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 great grandson, you can't give them zakat. Similarly, great, great, great grandfather, you can't give them zakat. So anyone who's in that particular, on that particular line, you cannot give them zakat. Even though they're poor, you cannot give them zakat. We're going to look at it in next week's lesson when we do subscribe fitr, that if you have like parents who are poor, then it's a right, you have another right to financially support them. The same way like when you get married, you are obliged to support your wife, your children. Similarly, if you have parents, you are obliged to support them financially. You don't look at your speaking, inshallah. Similarly, if you have a brother who's like, for example, poor, and also he's unable to work in terms of, say, for example, he's disabled, he can't work, and he's poor, so now he's also under your care in terms of you are now financially obliged to help him and support him. We look at that next week, inshallah. But what this text is telling us is that if you have a father who's poor, or grandfather who's poor, you don't give him zakat, but instead you are obliged anyway by the Sharia to financially support him, whatever you earn, you need to give him some money so that he looks after himself. So remember, ancestors, descendants, you can't give them zakat. He also goes and says, وَلَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّهِ وَجَدَّاتِهِ وَإِنْ عَلَتْ Similarly, you can't give zakat to your mother and to your grandmother all the way up. Like your great-grandmother and so on, you can't give them zakat at all. He then goes on to say, وَلَا إِلَىٰ إِمْرَأَتِهِ And nor can you give zakat to your wife. Okay, now, when you look at it, according to the principles of what we looked at, some may argue and say, well, you can or you should be giving zakat to your wife, or you can be giving zakat to your wife, in terms of, as I explained before, that a husband and wife, they're considered separate when it comes to zakat. What I mean by that is like, whatever your wife owns, you know, the gold she possesses and so on, it's her responsibility to pay zakat. Okay? Obviously in our Asian family we tend to pay together, but I'm just talking about like technically, you know, it's her responsibility. If she's got like a separate account, it's her responsibility to pay zakat. You know, if she's got some other kind of business by herself where the husband starts interfering, it's her responsibility to pay zakat. What I'm trying to say is that husband and wife, they're considered separate when it comes to zakat. Okay, if the husband is giving his zakat, the wife isn't, husband's not going to be held responsible. He won't be held responsible. Why did you pay your wife zakat? Because the wife, she's free, she's sane, she's mature, she's got understanding, she should know the importance of zakat, and she doesn't, then she'll be in trouble in the hereafter. Now, what this text is telling us is that even though they're considered separate, and remember, it's only like people who are separate, you can't give them zakat. So when you look at it hypothetically, you shouldn't be allowed to give your wife zakat in one way when you look at it. But the problem is, and this is obviously understandable as well, is because if you were to give your wife zakat, then what's going to happen is that indirectly you're going to benefit from it. Yes? And remember this principle that whenever you're indirectly benefiting from your zakat wealth, you can't give that person zakat. So you've got your wife here, now if you were to give her zakat, now obviously she's going to buy something, just say she buys food. Now that food she's going to buy, obviously she's going to cook it, you're going to be eating as well, so you're kind of benefiting from it. Or just for example, she wants to use the zakat money for, to buy, a sofa or something like that, just say for example. So again, you'll be sitting on the sofa, you'll be relaxing, you'll be sleeping, you'll be doing everything, you're kind of benefiting from the zakat money. So what I'm trying to say is that because there is that danger, or there is the assumption that you give your wife zakat money, you are also going to benefit from it as well. Therefore, to give your wife zakat would not be allowed. And I was explaining that, remember, situations where you are going to be benefiting from the zakat, that would not be allowed. So I'll give you another example where, just for example, you hire someone to do a job for you. Wash your car, something like that. Now just say, you're going to give him £10, but you've got £10 zakat money. So you can't give him that £10 zakat money. Why? Because you're giving him the zakat money, but also at the same time, you kind of benefited from it in terms of he also done a job for you. Like you wash your car, or you visit your house, or he does, did some painting, or he did some leafleting or something like that, or whatever. So obviously you can't you can't use the zakat money for your own advantage. So basically, if someone's doing a job for you, it could be like you hire someone to teach your kids. So again, you can't give him zakat money. Because with the intention that it's like whatever he's supposed to give him, hourly rate, it's also covering his, what he's teaching your kids, also covering that, you're not allowed to do that, okay? Obviously, if you are giving him his wages separately, and then on top of that, he happens to be poor, and then you say, okay, this is like zakat separate, yes? That's okay, all right? But you can't give him zakat money with the intention that he's zakat and also for the service which he has done for you. So that's not allowed. Okay, the next text then goes on to say that can you give zakat to a young child? A child is young, somebody else's kid is poor, can you give him zakat? Now remember, the ruling here depends on his parents. If his parents are rich and this child is poor, you can't give him zakat. Because remember, children below puberty or who are under the age of puberty, they are subservient to their parents. So if their parents are rich, automatically their children are rich. You probably hear stories like parents are living lavishly, but then they got children, but they kind of don't feed them properly, they don't look after them properly, they give them like scruffy clothing and so on. There are situations like that. So now if a child, he looks like poor to you, he's got like, ripped clothing and he looks all, his hair is all over the place, and you think he's poor, but then after some further investigation, you realize that no, his parents are quite well off. Not rich, but kind of well off, who are not obviously entitled to zakat. You can't give this poor child zakat. However, if this poor child has matured, and he is still poor, you can now give him zakat. Why? Because as soon as a child matures, he's now considered to be like, responsible for his action, now considered to be adult, he's now responsible for his action. So if he's now poor, he's not connected to his parents anymore. So even though his parents are rich, they're living a nice life, but the child here is struggling and is poor, then you can give him zakat. Okay. So remember, giving children zakat for a poor child depends on the parents. If the parents are rich, then obviously you can't give them zakat. However, if their parents are poor, you can give them zakat. Or if that child now matures, and he's still poor, then you can give him zakat, because as soon as he matures, then we don't consider him to be subservient to the parents anymore. It then takes me on to one of the questions which the brother asked last week with regards to child trust fund. Now, remember, child trust fund, the ruling is that, as I just explained before as well, that a child, someone who's a child, he doesn't give zakat. Okay, he doesn't give zakat. And remember, if a father, he's got some money, but with the intention that I'm going to give it to my child when he grows up, because it's in the father's possession, or something in Arabic we call qabza, the father will have to give zakat on that amount. So let's just look at it generally. Forget child custom for the time being. Just say generally, like, say for example, somebody has, or the father's got some money. He's got some money, and he's made his immature child the owner of that money. Like basically, he just gave it to him. Like for example, as I explained a couple of weeks ago, that sometimes, you know, the father, he makes a bank account for the child, and so everything, the father, the money he got, he gave it to the child. So it's as though that the child owns that money now. Now in that case, in that situation, there is no zakat for the father, because he transferred all the money to the child. And also there's no zakat on the child. Why? Because he's immature and he's not subjected to zakat rules yet. Okay, so that's like general, okay? If say for example, if the father's got some money, he's got it saved with him, and his intention is that, look, I'll give it to my child when he's mature or when he grows up a bit more, then I'll give the zakat, then I'll give the money to him. Then in that situation, because the father's got, what do you call, possession of that money, and he hasn't transferred it to the child, the father will have to give zakat on that amount. Okay? Now this takes me on to the child trust fund. Now the child trust fund is slightly different in terms of, as you know, that you have to be 18, or the child has to be 18 before you can start using the money. Now again, the ruling here is that any money which has been deposited by the parents into this trust fund, obviously the father, when he deposited that money, he's lost his possession over that money. So he doesn't have to give zakat anymore. But similarly, the child doesn't have to give zakat. Child meaning like he's mature, obviously he's become mature at 12, 13, now he's become mature a bit earlier, but around that age, so he's got no, what you call, control over that money, because he only gets control of the money when he's 18. So at this moment in time, even the child will not give zakat on that money. Why? Because he doesn't have control over that money. So when the parents deposited that money into the thing, they've lost their control over that because they've transferred it onto the child's ownership, so they don't have to give zakat. But similarly, at the same time, the child doesn't have to give zakat, even though he's mature, even though he's 13, 14, he's mature, he's subjected to zakat rules. But because you have to be 18 before you can access that particular amount, that child would not give zakat on that particular amount. And another ruling here very quickly is with regard to pensions. Again, brother probably one of the brothers asked last week. Remember, pensions, there are two situations. One is like the example, the government, by law, they are deducting a certain amount for your pensions, okay? You know, when you get the wage slip, yes, it tells you, you know, the contributions and so on and so forth. Now, with that particular amount, what happens is that when you now reach the pension age, and then you get that lump sum, you don't have to give zakat for the previous year, because you may be working for, say, for 30 years, and then when you reach, I don't know, 60, I'm not sure when is your pension age, 65. See, sometimes you get pensions a bit early, you know. What I'm trying to say is that, one of the pensions is that some people, some of them retire at like 30, they're retired and they're not working anymore. You have some stories like, he's only around 30, the guy, he's healthy, but he said, are you working? He goes, no, I'm not going to work anymore, I'm retired. So he's retired at 30, so anyway, that's another issue. So what I'm saying is that at the age of 65, so you get your pension. So you know, the 30 years you were working prior, you don't have to give the card for that. But obviously when you get this lump sum, then obviously every year thereafter, which passes, you have to give the card on that. And then the second situation is obviously if somebody voluntarily takes a pension scheme, like with not with your workplace, but something separately, then obviously the ruling is that the money which you now get, obviously at this moment in time, you don't have to give zakat because you kind of invested it, okay? So you're going to get it later on. So obviously what happens is that the money which you now get afterwards, you will have to give zakat for the previous years because you've invested that money into a pension. The main difference between this one and the first one is that, you know, in the first one, because the government by law deducted that money, so you didn't actually have any kind of possession over it. Only time you're going to get possession is obviously afterwards. But in this second one here, when you are voluntarily taking your pension scheme up, because you had possession over that, and then you put it into a pension scheme, then obviously, because you had possession over it, so you'd have to give zakat for the previous year. Obviously, another issue here, whether you are allowed to or not, obviously, as you know, the ruling is that voluntarily not, you should not take a pension scheme up, because obviously they then use that investing interest and other kind of stuff. So voluntarily you should actually take a pension scheme, but obviously if it's by law of the country, then you can. Okay, we'll just leave it there for this. Questions?